Last week, in our first reflection on Lent, I referred to prayer, fasting, and almsgiving on the foundation for Lenten spirituality. These three pillars of the spiritual life come right from Jesus' teaching on the Sermon on the Mount in the Gospel of St. Matthew. And while they are important for the spiritual life all year long, today we're going to reflect on why they are especially important during Lent. Remember now, the overall purpose of Lent is to draw us into deeper communion with God through conforming our lives more perfectly to the way of Christ. We know that because of sin, our nature has been wounded. Rather than the harmony with our God, our neighbor, and ourselves that Adam and Eve had before the fall, our lives are now marked by what the Catechism calls concupiscence. It's a big word, but what concupiscence refers to is the disordered inclination towards sin that all of us must struggle with. Because our nature has been wounded by sin, our lives are marked by a constant struggle between vice and virtue. And while we receive new life as adopted children of God through the sacrament of baptism, we still journey through life wrestling with the temporal consequences of sin, like death, illness, suffering, and concupiscence. In the Catechism, which is our faithful guide to the teachings of the Church, this disordered inclination towards sin is described as a triple concupiscence, which consists of an unnatural desire for the pleasures of the senses, covetousness for earthly goods, and self-assertion. Another way of stating this is that concupiscence is our fallen nature as it manifests itself primarily in lust, which is the disordered desire for pleasures of the senses, in greed, our disordered desire for wealth and material things, and pride, our disordered desire for self-mastery and independence. When we understand this triple concupiscence, we see that the practices given to us during the season of Lent are meant to provide a remedy for precisely these disordered inclinations towards sin. For example, fasting is a discipline that seeks to overcome our disordered desire for the pleasures of the senses. When we fast, we renounce the cravings of the body so that we might better order our lives and our desires according to the truth and goodness of God. Through almsgiving, we imitate the self-offering love of Jesus Christ Himself for the sake of others. This serves as a remedy for our disordered inclination towards greed and selfishness. And when we pray, we acknowledge our absolute dependence upon God and our inability to do anything without Him. This serves as a remedy for our disordered tendency to pride and arrogance. Seen in this light, the Lenten practices of prayer, fasting, and almsgiving are far more than just arbitrary disciplines that the Church imposes on us to make our lives miserable. They are spiritual exercises that are meant to assist us on the path of salvation, to conform us more perfectly to a properly ordered life of virtue and holiness. The value of these Lenten practices is reflected more fully in what our Church calls the evangelical counsels: chastity, poverty, and obedience. Most of us know that those who consecrate themselves to the religious life, like nuns, brothers, and many priests, take vows to live their lives according to these evangelical counsels. But they're not restricted to just priests and nuns in various forms, and are held up for all of us to embrace. It's easy to see how living by the disciplines of chastity, poverty, and obedience serve as a remedy for the triple concupiscence that marks our fallen nature. Through chastity, we seek to properly order the desires of the flesh. Through poverty, we seek to order all the goods of this world to the attainment of heaven as our greatest good. And through obedience, we seek to overcome our disordered inclination toward power, pride, and disobedience. These counsels are different from the Ten Commandments, which we are all required to obey. The purpose of the Ten Commandments is to enable us to truly love God and our neighbor. The evangelical counsels, on the other hand, are not commanded of us, strictly speaking, but they are very important to the Christian life because they clearly help us to more perfectly love God and to love our neighbor as ourselves. Living these vows faithfully serve to remove whatever might hinder this love from growing to perfection. For example, most of us are not called to beg for our food and drink like St. Francis, but we can certainly restrain ourselves from the constant consumption that dominates many people's lives. Celibacy, which is how single men and women live chastely, would be inappropriate for the married state. But chastity, the virtue of moderation and self-control, is indeed essential for a healthy marriage. And all of us are called to obedience to God, to the church, to our parents when we're young, and for married couples to their wedding vows, and for me to my bishop. So we can easily see that the exact form in which we live out the evangelical counsels may differ according to our age and our state of life. The need to live them remains true for all of us. Concluding, let me say a few words about almsgiving. In the strictest sense, it means giving money and food to those who are in need. One of the side effects of fasting during Lent is that we spend less money of our own on creature comforts and have more money and resources available to give away. Many parishes participate in the Rice Bowl campaign, but even just giving a little extra to St. Vincent de Paul or another outreach to the poor will accomplish this goal. Along those same lines, Lent is a good time to go through your closet and garage to give away some of those things that have been piling up and that you no longer use. I know it can be difficult giving away things that you've owned for a long time, but the act of detaching from them and letting someone else use them is an excellent response to the call for almsgiving, calling us to prayer and fasting as well. Lent provides a perfect opportunity for us to see just how we are doing in the battle against triple concupiscence, the battle against lust, greed, and pride. By challenging ourselves in these three important ways, we can expect to draw closer to the Lord and deepen our capacity for love. Of course, that is the point of all of our Lenten practices. So rather than looking at Lent as a series of painful deprivations, it's far more accurate to see it as a time to focus on where we are in our walk with the Lord and the call we've all received to live as children of the light. Next week, we'll reflect on the need for repentance and conversion, another one of the great themes of this holy season of Lent. May God bless you and your family as we open our hearts to what God wants to do for us during this blessed season.
More shows can be seen on Faith and Life Television at faithandlifetv.com.